edit, okay? I can set the start and the end point for which I want the live drum to play, okay? So what does that mean? It means that I can, here, I can record, tabs record means I record the activity, you know, if, whatever I'm pressing fail or I'm pressing a break or a start or stop, that gets recorded. But the automation here is what? I want to be able to go here, okay, with edit, and I want to be able to say, listen, I want the live drums to start playing from measure number, for the sake of this example, let's just say 8, all right? I want to just start playing at number 8, from measure 8, and I want the live drum to stop playing at measure, just for the sake of this example, to stop playing at measure 16 plus 8, 24.
Wow.
This is what it sounds like. So in the beginning, of course, you can do whatever you want to do, okay? There is no live audio drum there. But the live audio drum only kicks in at the measure that you programmed it for, which I believe in this case was 11. Whole idea is the automation of it, you know, being able to go ahead and put in the live drums when and where you want them to appear in the mix. And then of course you can go back and save that again as a MIDI file, so that when you're on stage, all you have to do is to simply touch the MIDI file and then play along with it, right? So that's the drum remix in a nutshell with regards to MIDI files. Another thing that you can do with the MIDI files is to be able to synchronize text files or audio files to the MIDI file. That's pretty simple. Let me show you in this example over here. How do you synchronize, for example, an audio file to a MIDI file? This has been a very, very highly requested feature, which we've implemented here on the Lounge, Keytron Lounge. So let me show you how it's done. It's a very simple thing. As a matter of fact, with the new OS, all you have to do is have the MIDI file and your wave have the same name. That's it. So if your MIDI file is john.mid, your wave file should be john.wav, and that's it. When you play the MIDI file, as you start playing the MIDI file, it will automatically start playing that wave file. But let me give you this example here. So let's look at the screen. Let me get myself out of that screen for a second. So this is what you have right now. Again, I'm going to go ahead and use one of these Ajamsonic examples, going into, let's say, the MIDI file folder. And I'm going to go into Michael Jackson's folder. May his soul rest in peace. He was a great artist indeed, great pop artist. And then now, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to pick the MIDI file. Now, if you see what I did, I'm going to use the song he made famous, Beat It. And I have two of each in there. Let me tell you what it is. C stands for chorus and V is for verse. So this file, I have the verse wave file linked to it. And on this one, I have the chorus. So let's do the verse first. So I'm going to start this file, which is a MIDI file. Let's zoom in on the screen, so you see exactly what is going on here in real time. And I want you to actually understand. That's why I'm trying to, you know, go slow with these tutorials and also split them up, so you can always go back and rewind if at all we lost you anywhere, okay? So this is a MIDI file. It's gonna play this wave file over here once I start playing the MIDI file. Does that make sense? So when I hit start on this MIDI file, it starts to play, or I press enter either way, okay? And if this is done correctly, what's gonna happen is at the appropriate time, based on how we design the wave file, it will start singing, Michael will start singing the verse. Okay, so this is the MIDI file. And to prove to you that it's a MIDI file, again, we can do all our normal things. Go back into GM, for an example, and you can see the general MIDI parts. Okay? And you go into the bass, and then touch the bass, and you change an instrument just to prove that it's a MIDI file. Okay? different bass over there. Make it louder, lower. Make it heavy. Let's go back into MIDI file now. That's the MIDI file playing together on the way. Okay? Again, it's a MIDI file, why? And right now, the different parts. I can read the parts, I can solo the parts. So again, that's very interesting. Some people are asking, what did he just do there? So the MIDI file and the WAV file have the same name. And it could be any WAV. A WAV file could contain drums, saxophone, water flowing down the street, rain on the raindrops. It's up to you. But you have to make sure that your WAV file, the tempo of that WAV file matches the tempo of the MIDI file you're trying to associate it with, okay? Let me do one more example, okay? I showed you two files in the folder over there, right? One was for the verse, one was for the chorus. Let me go ahead and load that MIDI file with the chorus, okay? And while that's playing, let me show you something. Some people are asked about having an external monitor. Yes, if I showed you this output right here, over to the side, you do have an external monitor that you can output. You can actually plug this. Let me get that label out. You can actually plug this, okay, out into another external monitor. So you can actually have this DVI output going to the HDMI of your monitor. But we've added so much to the screen now. Guess what? If I go into this screen, I can just simply zoom, okay? I can have bigger lyrics. Is that cool? Let's do it again. Zoom out. I can have access to my functions. Or if I put this on the screen, I just zoom in and I have access to that. Isn't that cool? Very interesting, right? Zoom out. And of course, zoom in. Let's go into that and see what exactly is happening. Listen to that as well. The WAV file comes from the chorus, the MIDI chorus, as we call it. Get taken down for copyright infringement and all that, but this was just to show you again an example how do you synchronize in this case a MIDI file with a WAV file. You can also synchronize a MIDI file with a text file or with a PDF. Again, they all have to have the same name, okay? Again, they all have to have the same name. Just maintain your extensions. Again, the same name. Now, in this next example, I'm going to demonstrate how you can use a microphone with the built-in Voicetron, that's Keytron's vocalizer, and have vocal harmonies accompany you as you're singing. Now, there's two ways to do this. You know, the vocalizer can recognize either chords that are entered into the machine with the MIDI controller, right, or having the MIDI file send dedicated notes to the vocalizer, to the harmonizer, to tell it what exact notes to produce while you're singing. And the later of the two examples is what I'm about to demonstrate to you right now. So a couple of things you want to do prior to getting there is setting up the machine to be able to recognize that, okay? So what you want to do, first of all, is go into menu and you touch the microphone number one vocalizer icon right there, okay? And that brings up two columns. The first column right here is your microphone setting, and the next column right here is your vocalizer, your harmonizer. So let's focus over on this one right here. First and foremost, you want to turn the microphone on, okay? So if I do this right now, it's bring myself in on this split screen. So I have this microphone here, very nice Sennheiser microphone. And if I sing into that mic, okay? Once I turn it on, once I turn on the microphone here, you can hear me now, right? I guess you can now hear me clearly, correctly. So now I'm speaking into this microphone. You can hear the reverb, you can hear the different effects on there, okay? I can also go to talk mode. If I hit talk, it takes away all the reverb stuff, and I'm just talking to you, my audience, okay? So
go back in and take out the talk, and we're back where we started at before. So now what I want to do is I want to go back into this menu, and I have the volume of my lead mic, which is this microphone right here. I'm going to turn that down a little bit because I want the vocal harmonies to stand out more. This is the volume for the harmonizer, so I want to make that loud as can be, right, for the most part. And I want to turn on the harmonizer, okay? Now, this is the trick of the game. Down here where it says preset left and right, this is what you use to determine where the vocalizer or where the harmonizer, let's get into the screen, should get its cue from, okay? And I'm going to select, you have right, which means if you're using the MIDI keyboard controller, you want the right-hand voices or whatever you play to the right of the split point to control the harmonizer, okay? If you select left, it means you want the left side, for those of you who play the arranger keyboard. Now, if you select MIDI, it means you want the MIDI file to control the harmonizer. So the first thing you want to do is to set this on MIDI, okay? Now, that's good and fair. You get out of there, microphone is on, as you can see from the tab over here. If I switch over to the top of the screen, you see the microphone on and off. It's on right now, it's red. So that's what your panel should look like, with the microphone on and the vocalizer ready to go. Now, the next setup is going to be in your MIDI file itself. What you have to do is, you have to be careful here. Some MIDI files already have pre-programmed notes for vocal harmonizers, normally on channel 5 for the most part, but check with your MIDI file. I'm going to go back into my Michael Jackson again. I'm going to keep it simple. And I'm going to go back in here, and I'm going to go into the GM. I can see all the different parts again, like before, right? Now, I know that for this particular song, the harmony tracks are on channel synth vocal, which is channel 3. So what you do is, all these are assigned to either voice, drums, or vocalizer. Like if you go to track number 10, which is your drums, you touch and hold that, you see it's assigned to a drum kit right down here. Part mode says drum. You could make it either a drum 1, a drum 2, or a voice or the vocalizer. So you can assign any of these tracks to control the harmony. Here we're going to go in track number 3, and it says voice right now. We're going to put that into the voice drum, which means that track, the notes, the actual MIDI notes on that track are going to trigger the harmonizer. This is a lot more accurate than when you use just a global chord to trigger the harmonizer, okay? And we're good to go. Press start. And now, if you notice, it does say, while it's playing, sorry. I'm gonna go back in here and do it while it's playing. Voice drum. So now when I sing at the appropriate time, the harmonizer is going to harmonize my voice. So while that's happening, sit around, look at the screen and enjoy it. Beautiful color touch screen.
That's just a snapshot of what you can do with regards to using this as a MIDI file player, especially when you're talking about the vocal harmonizer. Again, like I said, we're going to discuss in this section number 2 when you're using a MIDI controller like an accordion or like a keyboard or a guitar, you can actually do a lot more as well too. But these are just some of the standalone features that we're talking about when it comes to the Keytron Lounge. So, it's been a long day, morning, afternoon, or evening. We're about to take a very, very short break, but before I do that, I want to lead you on into the next topic that we're going to cover for today, and that's going to be the audio multitracks. So, what exactly is the audio multitrack? For those of you who have either of the following AJAM Sonic modules, SD40 or SD90 or the Mid-J Pro, if you go into the multitrack folder, this demonstration also applies to you. So really, like I said before in the beginning, MIDI gives you the versatility, the power to control everything, all the different elements that make up your song, down to the tracks and the content of the tracks. With audio, you get the clarity, the sound quality, but you don't have that capability. With the Keytron Lounge, you have the best of both worlds. And this new feature I'm about to talk about is almost like a music minus one capability, right? So you're dealing with audio files, a 5.1 surround sound like what's used in the movie theaters, right? But now imagine being able to play an audio file and mute the individual tracks of that audio. Yes, so I can take out the vocals, or take out the bass guitar, or take out the drums, or mute to get the strings, right? This is ultimately the power that you would like to have on all the audio that's out there. But I'm just gonna give you this little quick example here as we dive in. So before we do that, like I said before, let's take a very short break. Don't forget, for those of you who are watching us on YouTube, to subscribe to this channel and turn on your notification, your bell notification, because we're going to be posting now on a regular basis and you don't want to miss out on any of these important videos. So subscribe to our YouTube channel, click on your post notification so you're alerted once we post a video and you can watch the videos. And we're also going to have snippet, shorter versions of videos, about 3 to 4 minutes of these various topics as well on the channel. So you definitely want to subscribe. And as you do that, we're going to go ahead and pick up after this advertisement.